Thanks.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, I'm Stefan from Gnosis, and yeah, thanks for joining this session, even though it's quite late already. So if you know Gnosis, you probably connect Gnosis with prediction markets. And we will have a presentation on prediction markets tomorrow. Llama will give a presentation, I think, at 11 o'clock. Today I will talk about another project that we do at Gnosis, and we call it Gnosis Safe. And Gnosis Safe is the successor of the Gnosis Multisig. So eventually many of you actually know this application. Just 1 year ago, also here in Paris, we were presenting the Gnosis Multisig. And what the Gnosis Multisig essentially does, it allows everyone to create multisigs and maintain multisigs. The reason why we created this was because at that time there was no multisignature wallet available that allowed to store and transfer ERC20 tokens. It was a time when Ether was still at $10 and there was the whole ICO hype just started. And there was also no easy and comprehensive user interface available to actually do multisig transactions. There was no interface available to do like easy cold storage, and that's why we put effort in building interface for this. So this here is the Gnosis mainnet multisig. You can see we really trust it, and yeah, many have been using it. So today, it's mostly used to maintain ICO funding. It's also great to be transparent. Yeah, everyone can see how you are spending your funds, and it's easy for everyone to understand. You don't have to be a computer scientist in order to sign and send transactions. It's especially important, like those that are maintaining the funds are not only us. There are many people involved in organizations, and they all should be able to understand what kind of transactions they are actually signing. Yeah, again, like what were the features? We had, yeah, multisig, it is a multisig wallet for ERC20 tokens. It allows cold storage, offline signing, and it even has hardware wallet support. So if you have a Nano Ledger wallet, then you can use it together with this multi-signature wallet. But there are some issues with this wallet, not security related, but there are ways to improve it because using this wallet is quite expensive. So again, like at the time, Ether was at $10 and the gas price, there was no CryptoKitties, there was no network congestion, so the gas price was very low. And that's why when we designed this multisig wallet, we didn't pay too much attention on making it really gas efficient. Also, it was not really flexible. Like once it's deployed, you cannot upgrade it, you cannot extend the functionality. And even though the UI was pretty comprehensive, it was still targeting more educated Ethereum users, so you still have to understand what is the gas price, what is gas in general, and those are all still issues that we have to solve if we want to make Ethereum really successful and get everyone involved. And that's why we decided to create a new version of this multisig, and we decided to redesign our smart contract architecture because that's required in order to make it more gas efficient. So here, a comparison for like how much you have to spend on creating the old multisig wallet. So creation costs like 2 million gas, which results in a price of $3, assuming that you pay 2 GB, and the price of Ether is around $800. Of course, like there were times when the gas price was much higher and people had to pay with a price of 60 GB, and then I think like the most expensive installation was around $160 for just creating a multisig wallet. And then eventually some of those transactions unfortunately failed, so they were just wasting their money. Then transaction execution, also really expensive. on average, like if you're doing an ERC20 transaction via the current multisig, you spend around $0.50, assuming that the gas price is 2 GB. Creating a new smart contract architecture helped us to reduce those costs a lot. So you can see here, like creating a new multisig wallet now costs only 170,000 gas, and the transaction costs are also significantly lower. They are not much higher than actually just doing regular ERC20 token transfers. So why was the old multisig so expensive? Basically, the way or the easiest way to deploy new contracts for a long term time was just redeploying the same bytecode over and over again. And actually, even Solidity, if you're using a smart contract factory, it was just deploying the same bytecode again and again and again. And this is a really expensive operation. And sending transaction was expensive because the easiest way, like if you do a multisig wallet, then you have multiple parties, right? And they all have to know about what transactions they should be signing. And at that time, Whisper was not really working very well. So we decided, OK, let's just sync the data that should be signed via the smart contract. So essentially, you were writing the transaction data into the smart contract, which is a very expensive operation. And that's why transactions became so expensive. So how can we solve this? How did we decrease the costs of deployment? What we did is we created a new concept, proxy contract design. The idea is that instead of deploying the same bytecode for the multisig again and again and again, what we do is we save one master copy of this bytecode. And of course, we have to make sure that there's no way you can ever delete this master copy. And then what you do is you create a proxy contract. And what this proxy contract essentially is doing is it delegates all transactions to this master copy. And thanks to the Byzantium hard fork, there was a change that allowed to also return dynamically sized data. And this finally allowed us to really have the same functionality within the proxy contract as you would have in the master copy. So the way the proxy contract works, it points to the reference contract or the master copy contract and delegates all calls. And the great thing is that this master copy, that this proxy contract can be minimal. It just implements this one fallback function. And that's why it's really cheap to deploy. And the great thing is also that in case you are storing the master copy address as the first storage in this proxy contract, then you can implement rules in the master copy how this can be updated. So essentially, it allows you to update the functionality of the multisig without actually having to move funds from the old multisig to a new multisig with new functionality. You keep the same address, so that's really convenient. To have a look how this actually works, so we have the proxy contract. It points to the Gnosis Safe contract 1.0. And the proxy contract has the storage. It has the address to the master copy. It has addresses of safe owners and a threshold, etc. And now let's say we would like to update the functionality. Then we send a transaction, change master copy to Gnosis Safe 2.0. This transaction is sent to the proxy contract. The proxy contract is using the code in the Gnosis Safe 1.0, where there's a function update master copy. And this function is executed within the context of the proxy context storage and updates the master copy to Gnosis Safe 2.0. So any transaction that is sent now to the proxy contract will always be executed using the code of the Gnosis Safe contract 2.0. And to give you an idea what the change in bytecode is, so on the left side you see the bytecode of the multisig, and on the right side you see the bytecode that's required for the proxy contract. So yeah, it's a significant difference. And then transaction execution. So yeah, we obviously decided to not store any transaction data anymore in the smart contract. Instead, what we do is every party involved in this process, they are signing a transaction message, And those messages, they can be collected and then sent once you know that you reach the required threshold, then they are sent at once to the smart contract. The smart contract can verify the signatures of those messages and then decide if the transaction should be executed or not. There's also an alternative way. So the problem is, if you know smart contract development, you know that smart contracts, they don't have a private key, so they cannot sign messages. But what we would like to allow is that a Gnosis safe owner can be also a Gnosis safe. So you can do like nested multisigs. And this requires that also smart contracts can confirm transactions. So that's why we also built this into this smart contract. You can confirm via a signed message, but also via a regular Ethereum transaction. And again, like the gas costs overhead for doing multisig transactions is now quite minimal. You pay for an ERC20 token transaction, you pay an overhead of 10,000 gas. ERC20 token transaction regularly costs like around 50 to 60,000 gas, so it's reasonable. Also, what we support is delegate calls. So, like until today, all multisig wallets, they support regular calls. Now we allow also to directly do delegate calls from the multisig. This is dangerous because if you execute like another contract code within the context of the safe, then this can change the storage. So you have to be careful, and all those addresses that you are using via delegate calls have to be whitelisted. However, it's really convenient if you want to do more complex setups. So for example, if you want to create a new Gnosis safe and you want to add additional functionality like, we would like to add a daily limit, or we want to add a whitelist where we can do transactions to even without the requirement of multiple signatures. What's also possible is you can create new contracts directly via the safe. So it supports this create opcode. And that's sometimes important if you want to make the safe an owner of another contract. We also introduced a new concept of extensions. So what extensions actually are is just another smart contract. And they allow you to define alternative rules for execution. So the normal rule is just saying, OK, we need n out of m signatures. If they all agree, then we execute. But now we can extend the functionality and add new rules. And the only function that they have to implement is executable function, where you pass on the transaction data. And this contract will return if the execution is allowed or not. So examples for those extensions could be a daily limit extension where you can define how much Ether or ERC20 tokens you would like to withdraw on a daily basis without having to confirm with multiple signatures. Or a whitelist extension or anything else. One thing that is quite interesting is because there's a delegate call, we can extend the functionality. And one interesting additional functionality is the multi-send library. Those of you that are using dApps like EtherDelta or have participated in Olympia, our test run, they know that for every ERC20 token, like for most interactions with dApps, you are always required to approve tokens first, and then you do an additional call to the smart contract, so the smart contract can withdraw those tokens and then do something with it. For example, buying shares on the prediction market or on EtherDelta, fulfilling an order. And this is a really bad user experience, so there can be like multiple steps or multiple signature requests required in order to do any transaction, and most users don't understand why they have to do this. So what we can do now is, thanks to the smart contract, we can batch those transactions together and ask the user only once to actually sign those. Yeah, so approve plus X, this all can be combined together. User has to sign once, and it can be executed at once. This also saves some gas costs because you don't have this additional fixed cost of 21,000 gas that you have with every transaction. So based on those new smart contracts, we are currently building two different products. We have the Gnosis Safe, what we call personal edition, where the target user is like anyone, and it's for personal use, so we expect that you are holding all the keys. And those keys can be on different devices that you own. So for example, we support that you have one key on your notebook, for example, in the Chrome extension, and one key on your phone, which is your main device to control the safe. And there, the target user is really anyone. So I know like MetaMask currently hit a milestone of 500,000 downloads, which is really, really impressive. But we think more about like how can we get the next, let's say, 50 million people onboarded to Ethereum. And there are just very different constraints. How can we actually make this happen? Because most users, they don't understand what is a private key, what are the implications of private keys. And yeah, we have to take all this into account in order to make sure that this can become actually successful. Then the other product that we would like to, or that we are building, is the Team Edition. And this is basically an update of the current Gnosis Multisig, just more gas efficient, and also with some UI improvements and usability improvements. So for the personal edition, again, like one person is owning one safe. The private key, like the user doesn't have to know about the concept of private key. So he doesn't know what the private key is. We don't even show the address of the private key to the user. The private key is never leaving the device. What are the big benefits of having multisig as contracts? So if you think about, there are also other ways like threshold signatures where you could just have like different devices participating in a threshold signature scheme, and then you don't need any smart contract at all. But what the smart contract allows you to do it is it allows you to integrate other rule sets which allow you to do executions under different conditions. And this also allows you to add recovery options. Yeah, so many people are losing access to their private keys for different reasons. Some maybe just forget their password, and there are many requests also for MetaMask. Oh, I forgot my password. Can you please reset my password? No, it's not possible. You just lost everything. And now, thanks to using a proxy contract, for actually accessing anything on Ethereum, we can build in recovery modes which allow you to gain access to your safe and to your assets again. So what we are currently building are two main software products. One is the phone app. So we are building a phone app for Android and iOS. And the idea is that the phone app is your interface to create a new safe. And also connect to any kind of application that runs on your phone. It allows you to list the assets that you have, to transfer assets, and to do the entire setup. And then in addition, we have a Chrome extension, and the Chrome extension allows you to use your notebook as a two-factor authentication device. Yeah, so if you want to, let's say you are using EtherDelta and you would like to do any kind of transfer, then you first have to confirm on your notebook. Then we send a push notification to your phone, and there again you have to confirm before it can be executed. So the Chrome extension serves as a relayer to your phone, and you can use the same account for any kind of app that is on your desktop as well as on your phone. So how can we do recovery of a device? So basically, recovery options are also just safe extensions. Yeah, they are implementing a different kind of rule for doing a transaction via the safe. And so there are two known ways how you could do recovery. One is the paralysis proof, where I can claim that I lost access to my safe. Then I have to put up a security deposit. And assuming that within a period of time, no one was able to execute any transaction from the safe, then I can get access to this smart contract. The problem with this is that it requires a very long waiting period, because otherwise, the waiting period is just 1 week, and I don't know, on holidays for 1 week, and I have no internet access, and somebody knows about this, obviously he can exploit the situation by just putting a security deposit, wait 1 week, and then he has access to it. So there's a little trade-off. The other option is to do something like social recovery, where you basically require another multi-signature wallet to confirm that you lost your device, and this multisig can be controlled by other third parties that you have to trust. I think initially, most were thinking, yeah, you can just use your friends to do this. I guess that might not be always the best option, depending on how depending on how much money is actually involved. So it will always require trust in third parties. So what we think is that we can improve on what has been done so far by offering a recovery service where the recovery process is depends on the value of assets that you hold in your multisig. So obviously, if there's not much value involved, then the recovery can be easy, and maybe you need just one third party that has to confirm that's actually you. But if you have suddenly lots of money in it, then it should be much more difficult, especially like, I don't know, like if you had 1,000 Ether in your wallet 1 year ago, it was not really that much of a security risk, but now it would be. The way how we can do this is we can leverage on-chain price oracles. If you would like to know how one of those can be built, there will be a presentation on Saturday about our decentralized exchange, which as a side effect is also a great way to estimate asset values on the blockchain. So who can be those trusted third parties? To be honest, we haven't really figured this out yet. We think those parties should be professional recovery services. There are many organizations and companies that have lots of experience with KYC processes. The basic flow would obviously be that at the time when you set up your safe, you have to provide some personal information to the service, those services that can be involved in the recovery process. They don't necessarily have to know exactly what your personal information is. It's probably sufficient if you just send them your information in a hashed format or encrypted format. And then at the time when you have to do recovery, then you can provide this information again. So there's one big problem with the onboarding process, and it's kind of a chicken egg problem. So let's say you want to create a new safe, you create a new Ethereum account, and now we have to create a smart contract. And in order to create a smart contract, you have to have funds. And now what we could offer is just send some money to the Ethereum account that was just created. But this is not really a great user experience. So the user that we currently have in mind is someone who has funds on the centralized exchange, and they just want to get this money off the centralized exchange to their safe. And now what they would have to do is they would have to first do a withdrawal request to the Ethereum account that was just created. Then they can create the Gnosis safe contract, and then they have to do a second withdrawal from the exchange to actually move the funds that they would like to maintain to their safe. And that's really not a great user experience. So the easy way to improve this experience is just say, okay, for this step, we can offer an in-app purchase. Yeah, so there's like not much value involved. There's actually like a usage of Ether just to pay transaction fees. You don't have to pay that much. So you can just buy this via an in-app purchase, and then we can take care of actually setting up the safe. And there's also no trust in us required because everything is signed with your key anyways, so there's no way we can actually interfere in this process. Then obviously we need also a way to communicate between the Chrome extension and the phone app. So there we use a regular notification service, this is a centralized service, the initial pairing between the Chrome extension and the phone is just a QR code, so you scan the QR code, this contains a secret and the a signature of the secret, and then we can establish a secure communication between the Chrome extension and the phone app. So let's say there's a transaction on your desktop, then you click yes, I agree on your notebook, then it's sent to your phone, you agree again, then this is sent to the transaction relay service, which is then sending it to Ethereum, and then the hash, or the transaction hash is passed back to the Chrome extension. So for the team edition, there we have some updates. So mostly it's really about reducing the gas costs. So we, as mentioned before, instead of having all the transaction data on the contract, it's all in signed messages. And we work also, of course, in trying to improve the user experience. So whenever, like let's say you set up a team save and you have different parties participating, they will all get push notifications at the time someone is requesting a signature from them. There will also be an integration with ENS, so in case you want to send transactions, then you can, instead of using addresses, you can just use the ENS entry. So because we don't save any data anymore on any smart contract, we still would like, of course, to show what happened in the past. So for this, we need a server similar to EtherScan, but very specifically to the data that we need. So we have a service running which keeps track on what kind of transactions were sent via our smart contracts. So at any point of time, you can have a list of all transactions that were sent via your save. And it also, of course, can list like confirmations that were sent via other smart contracts, and also can list what kind of deposits were made to your save. We also have a signed message service. So as mentioned, like, yeah, you have to somehow communicate what kind of messages or what kind of transactions were already signed by others. So that's why we built this one service, which allows you to exchange those messages between everyone participating. So I would like to show you a demo of a previous prototype that we did. It's an Android app, and I hope the video will work. So in this case, actually, the two-factor authentication is between two phones. We think it's an unlikely setup that someone will actually own two phones, but it would work. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, so basically now we create a new save. You see like the security level, of course, we'd like you to have to add another device. So to increase security, then you can add a device. Right now that's just pasting an address. And then you can select the transaction speed. And we'd let you know what the costs are for the deployment. Now this is currently taken from East Gas Station. Then the save is deployed, and then you can see like what kind of assets you own and what the transaction history is. You can go to settings and you can see you can replace a device, you can add a device, etc. Now we try to do a transaction. Now on the left side there's my save, and I would like to send some money to my dad, and I send 0.5 Ether. And now I can see, I confirmed this transaction, and now we send a push signature request. And now it will show up on my other phone, and there I can click on this notification and then confirm the transaction. I have to enter my master password, or I have to confirm with my fingerprint, and then the transaction, like the signature sent back to the phone, and then you click submit transaction, and then you can actually execute it. So this is like a previous prototype. There's still like quite a big difference between what we want to achieve and what this prototype can currently offer, but it gives you like a basic idea of how this can work. Yeah, I think that's it. Thank you. For the phone applications, we expect that the Android version will be available mid Q2 or end Q2, and iOS a little bit later. And the Team Edition will get a major update, also in Q2. And that's the team currently working on this. So we're putting effort into making this really work well. Thank you.
Hmm.
I don't know if there's time for questions. Okay. So if anyone has questions, please. I think you have to wait until.
Will it, well, thank you for your presentation. Will it be possible to do contract calls from the multi-signature?
Sorry, will it be possible to do?
Contract calls from the multi-signature.
Of course, yes. That's like the main, I mean, that's the, yeah, of course.
Thanks, Irfan. I love the wallet, especially with the lower gas costs. We have a lot of wallets to move when you have it ready. I have a question specifically for my company. So we're called Hello Gold. We kind of tokenize gold. We're building a permissioned blockchain, putting aside the whole discussions on permission versus public. The idea that we want is to have a wallet where one signature needs to sign off, and then other people can sign above a certain minimum amount. Do you personally see a need for it, and whether it's achievable to build on the Gnosis safe?
So let me try to recap. So basically, you would like to have a multisig where one person's always required.
Yeah.
And then depending on how much has to be sent, there are more signatures required.
Yeah.
Yeah, so basically, using this extension concept, you could build anything. I think it makes sense to use, like, basically also what I was mentioning with the recovery multisig goes in a very similar direction, where basically the threshold is defined by the amount of money that should be transferred. For this, you have to, of course, rely on an oracle that provides you price data. And ideally, you can use something that's where you don't have to trust a third party. So yeah, we are also working on that. but yeah, so yeah, I think it makes absolutely sense, yeah.
Oh yeah. thank you for your presentation first. And I have two questions. First question is about multi-sending. How would you solve the double spending problem if you do multi-sending? So you have multiple transactions at the same time. So, and how would you confirm the same method as transactions are confirmed? Or that's the first question.
Yeah, so fortunately, this problem is already solved by Ethereum, so we don't have to take care of this.
Okay. So like the first one will be, even if you send them all at the same time, the first one will be
exactly
confirmed, and after it will be checked the others?
Exactly.
Okay, thank you. And the second question is about, you said that the highest value there is in the safe, the more confirmation needed for in order to use the to be able to recover access for the safe.
Right.
So how would you, for example, like you have your safe and you have some people that will be your the people that will be asked after if you lose your private key in order for you to recover. So you will add other people the more you have value in the safe, or how does it work?
I mean, there are different scenarios possible, but ideally, like you would set up like a bigger list of KYC providers at the time when you set up this wallet. And then basically, let's say there are 10 different KYC providers, they all offer you to do recovery. And then, then you can go up to 10 required KYC providers in order to restore. But yeah, of course, like right now there's no KYC provider available. Let's say we start one, then maybe there's another one, then if you add this recovery option, then there are only two available. So it's limited. But of course, over time, there could be more. And then we could just ask the user, basically, now there are more KYC providers available. Would you like to do an update? And then he can confirm that he would like to, yeah, to add those as well.
So you said that you don't store the messages on the contract anymore. So do you store at least a hash of the message? Because otherwise people can cheat.
So it depends. So if assuming that we only collect signed messages, then the only thing that we have to make sure is that there's no possibility for replay attack. So any of those signed messages includes a nonce. And currently, it's implemented with a global nonce. So whenever a transaction is executed, we just increase this. So there's no way you could ever replay this. Other than this, we don't have to store actually anything in the smart contract.
At least a hash, yes. So I can double check what we store. And so I get the message from the centralized service.
Yeah.
It's on the phone, and I would like to check that, you know, the message I got corresponds to the transaction I want to prove on the smart contract.
Of course, like basically what the signed message service includes is the transaction payload, so everyone can validate that the hash of the transaction payload, which was signed, is what I actually also would like to sign. Well, it doesn't have to be stored on the smart contract. No, it doesn't have to. I mean, we can talk about it afterwards.
Hi, thanks for the presentation. A very small question, just because of the recovery things. So say I'm a slightly advanced user and I own, for example, a ledger. Would you also consider like those kinds of like quick, for me, easy, but still considered by myself, very secure approaches to just sign on the ledger that to recover?
So that would not be really like a recovery option as we expect it to be. It would be more like a 2 out of 3 multisig, where when you lose one device, you know that you have your ledger hardware wallet somewhere else. So that's possible, of course. That doesn't even require this recovery option that we have in mind. That's supported. But what we really would like to have is, basically, we are targeting like the user that doesn't really know about it. And also, even if you have your ledger wallet, what if for some reason it doesn't work anymore? And you don't have your crypto steal recovery option, then yeah.
So all the scenarios you've described so far are online signing scenarios in some way, shape, or form.
Right.
What about offline signing?
Yeah. So offline signing, you can do offline signing, but all of those scenarios, they would work offline as well. The infrastructure currently doesn't really like support it, but theoretically it's possible. Yeah.
So with the one global nonce, offline signing can't actually guarantee.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah, that's right. There's no guarantee. So that's something that would not work for state channels, unfortunately. Yeah, I agree.
Hey, is there something preventing the KIC or banks from censoring me or stealing my money? I mean, if they all cooperate, can they do this?
You're talking about the recovery scenario.
Yeah, exactly.
No, of course not. So basically, if all the trusted third parties that would be required would cooperate and collude, then yeah, they can steal your money.
Okay, thanks.
What's the roadmap?
Oh yeah, so the roadmap. Timeline basically like when we would like to do a mainnet release. Is in for the phone apps in Q2 and Q3, and for the team edition, so what will be replacing the multisig, it's also Q3. Yeah. Sorry?
It's for free?
Yeah, that's for free, yeah. No. All right, yeah, thank you very much.